Good morning and welcome to Four, starting the day with an American footballing blitz.
Hi, I'm Brad Johnson, quarterback of the Minnesota Vikings, and you're watching Channel 4, home of American football.
Final blitz of 1996, we see the AFC playoff race decided by the boot of an NFC kicker. And talking of the boot, P45s are being handed out like Christmas bonuses this week. We'll update you on the coaching casualty list. From sackings, we move to resignation, the acceptance that you're a lifelong Jets fan. There's nothing you can do about it. Mostly though, we're looking ahead to the Super Bowl, and as usual, offering you a chance to go too.
Good morning. We've got a lot to get through this week, so if you're all sitting comfortably wearing the NFL hats and sweatshirts you got for Christmas, we'll begin. And we'll begin in the AFC, where four teams entered the final weekend of the regular season, chasing three playoff places. Now, the Colts, the Chiefs and the Bills all had the same record, so the key to the wildcard race was Jacksonville, who were a game behind. If the Jaguars lost, then everyone else was in. But their opponents were Atlanta, who'd won a grand total of one away game all year.
In fact, not only have the Falcons won just one game on the road, they've only managed two at home, and no disrespect to Morten Andersen, but when the biggest star on the team is the kicker, you know you're in trouble. A win in the final game of a miserable season might not do much to save the job of head coach June Jones, but at least it might cheer up the fans before they headed home for Christmas. Halfway through the season, the Jaguars looked like being home for the holidays too. They lost six of their first nine, and all the talk in Jacksonville was about how the team had lost faith in the disciplinarian style of head coach Tom Coughlin. But Coughlin relaxed in the home stretch, and so did the Jags. Mark Brunell, the only quarterback in the league not to miss a single snap this season, led them to four straight wins coming into this game. And the way the tiebreakers worked out with the other teams in the race, one more put them in the playoffs. Last day of the regular season in Jacksonville, which meant players were allowed to bring their toys to school. Robert Massey and the Jaguars defense forced Atlanta to punt on their opening drive. So as we join Kevin Harlan and Bill Moss, Jacksonville are starting out from their own 23.
And Brunell goes right to work and throws in the pass caught. Jimmy Smith has a first down. Pick up a 14 on first down. He leads the AFC in receiving yards. First down out to the 37-yard line for Jacksonville with no score in the first handoff today to Natron Means. And he plows his way for about five, setting up second down and five and a tackle by Jesse Tucker.
Kevin, you know, it's no secret when you look at these two teams, and you know Jacksonville has all the firepower. They have the number two ranked offense in the NFL. And then you're playing against the worst defense in the NFL in the Falcons. And to a man, they're outmatched. But today, in order to keep up with the Falcons' offense, they've got to sustain drives. They, being the Jaguars, have to sustain drives, chew up the clock, and score at the end of those drives.
So that means a lot of means. He just carried the ball. Now with an empty backfield, second down and four for Brunell. Runs out of the pocket, throws a pass. Another catch made. Willie Jackson downfield into Atlanta territory. A pickup of 13 yards. And he's down to the 44-yard line. So a 14-yard throw to Smith. 13-yard throw to Willie Jackson.
And that's no surprise. It looks like that they're able so far in two passes to just pick them apart. And that's what you expected, you know, with their passing offense and the struggling secondary of the Falcons. But they're moving the ball by pass. But what they're going to have to concentrate on, Kev, what you said means, is they've got to run the ball also.
First down and 10 with a couple tight ends. Here comes Nezron Means, who was picked up off waivers from San Diego, and he is stopped in the backfield.
You know, I said they have to run them, and you saw the two times they've run them, they haven't gotten much yards. And the reason I say you have to run them, you say, well, why do you have to run it, Bill? You know, why not? Why not throw all over them? They have a bad secondary. Because I don't think Jacksonville, I don't think you want to get into a shootout with the Falcons. I don't think you would just want to keep passing the ball and have everybody throwing the ball all over the place. I think you have to methodically move the ball downfield, and that means.
Second down and 11 with no score. Opening drive for Jacksonville today. Brunell moves up nicely, throws again, third consecutive completion to the 27-yard line. This time the reception is made by Keenan McCardell. It's a gain of 18 yards.
At the top of the show, Kev, I told you about Mark Brunell and that he has been the reason for all their success. Watch him here. He's in the pocket, and then he feels it closing around him. He steps up into the middle of the pocket. This is a guy that's very aware of everything that's going on around him. He's a smart, intelligent kid, and he can feel things around him, and he's able to take advantage of them.
Very confident. 3 of 3 to start the game. Three different receivers. First and 10 handoff. Means run it well. Cuts outside and dives down to the 22. A gain of 6 yards, stopped by secondary player Brad Edwards.
You know, one of the things that Jacksonville did is they went in the draft and they went out and they got guys, offensive linemen. You know, and they got Tony Boselli last year, and he had a knee injury. But watch the job he does right here on Burrows. I mean, he just gets his man, and he just takes him and pushes him right out of the picture. I mean, you can't stop play run defense when you're getting blocked like that, and that's been a big problem for the Falcons.
Seventh play of the drive, second down and 4. Handoff again to Means, and he's by the 20, near a first down at the 19-yard line. They'll have 3rd and 1 coming up. Means, of course, Bill, takes the place of the injured James Stewart, as Tom Coughlin had to make that move in his backfield.
Well, they brought Means in. Remember, you said he got cut from San Diego, and then you have that big offensive line, and it's a natural fit. I mean, I played against Means when he was in San Diego, and this guy, he's a real load. He'll bring it to you, and then you get the big offensive lineman in front of him. I mean, they have to get this running game going.
Over 240 pounds, Nezron Means. Third down, a long one. Means gets the ball to first down. He needed 1, he got 5, and he's inside the 15. Rookie Craig Sauer makes the stop.
And Kevin, you know, I said they drafted Boselli. Well, on the other side, they went out in free agency, spent a bunch of money on getting Pittsburgh's Leon Searcy. Now watch the block here. And that's Burrows again, number 91. He just gets pushed right out of the picture, and they run the ball right behind him with Means. They spent their money wisely, Jacksonville, in building this team.
Big tackle, Searcy comes from the Pittsburgh Steelers. 9th play of the drive, another first down by Jacksonville. Hand off again to Means, claws his way to the 11. Picks up 4 on first down.
Well, they got down here nicely, and then they accomplished some of the things they wanted to do. And now, as we're talking to Tom Coughlin, what he has to do is he has to get points on the board. You have a nice drive like this, let's get points out of it. You chewed up some clock. And now let's capitalize on it. It's important for them. This is a big game for Jacksonville, and this is a young team.
2 tight ends, but Brown is split. Means with 22 yards so far. Second down from the 11-yard line. Opening drive by Jacksonville, and Brunell on the draw, the pump fake. He sees the end zone, and he's in for the Jacksonville touchdown. Pretty impressive drive.
It's a nice drive, and if you saw what got them down the field, it's Mark Brunell, and he's been the story for them all year.
Mike Hollis now will try the extra point. He has not missed a point after all season long. Brian Barker, the former Eagle and chief punter, is holding, punting now here in Jacksonville with great success. As the opening drive revolves around Brunell and Means, the extra point good.
An impressive opening drive for the Jags, but they couldn't repeat it as the Falcons defense tightened up to stop them 3 times inside the 10 and forced them to settle for field goals. Atlanta added one of their own before halftime, so as we join their first possession of the second half, They trail 16-3.
And out of the backfield, throws to the rookie running back Richard Huntley, who's up the sideline and has a first down. Hebert gets a block from Hayward, buys time, and on the run, needs to get to the 37, has the first down. Seventh play of the drive, first and 10, he gives him a good block there, and he dumps it in the flat, where it's caught by Tyrone Brown, and he wiggles his way free. Hebert got a block from Davis, and a touchdown pass caught by Eric Metcalf.
So Jacksonville's failure to turn all that first half possession into touchdowns, catching up with them. As were the Falcons. After the kickoff, Mark Brunell took the Jaguars on another long drive, hitting Derek Brown for 14 yards to move into Atlanta's half at the end of the third quarter. At the start of the fourth, though, he missed Keenan McCardell with his third down pass, and that brought kicker Mike Hollis back out.
Well, three consecutive field goals by Hollis. This will be his longest attempt today from 42 yards away. The snap may not have been down, but hits the uprights and ricochets in for three. How about that?
No style marks, but it put the Jaguars' lead back up to 9. By this time, though, the Falcons were moving the ball effectively themselves. And after Jamal Anderson picked up this first down on their next drive, Bert Emanuel took over.
Fake to Hayward, the throw on the flat. Here's the running shooter. It's best, and Bert Emanuel finds the crease. He's into Jacksonville territory to the 37-yard line. Hebert climbs inside and throws the pass. What a catch made at the 22 by Bert Emanuel. Hebert faced the rush, hits Emanuel. He's got some blocking. He's in open field, and Emanuel down to the 5. Hebert easily in, slicing his way for the Atlanta touchdown.
19-17, and if this was going to be June Jones' last game as Falcons head coach, he seemed determined to make it Tom Coughlin's last of the season. The Jaguars tried to run out the clock to preserve their two-point lead, but Brunell just got run out of the pocket and sacked eventually by Clay Matthews to force a Jacksonville punt. So with just under 4 minutes left, the Falcons got the ball back at their own 30-yard line.
And Anderson with the block from Hayward. Running to the side, getting close to the sideline. Was he knocked out of bounds? They blow it dead. And about the 32, will give him 2 yards on the carry, setting up second down and 8. We just see Morton Anderson. Where does he have to get that ball put down to kick the possible go-ahead touch field goal?
Well, they've got to go about 40 yards. You see, they need to go right to about there. That's about the 30-yard line. And you figure with a 7-yard snap, and you're looking at around 46, 47-yard field goal. And that's very makeable for Morton Anderson. And it doesn't matter at the end of the game. Morton's used to that.
23 game-winning kicks for Anderson over his career. Second down and 9. Hebert, second option. Got his receiver, Tyrone Brown. Gain of 5 to the 35. It'll be third down and 5.
Now watch what Bobby Hebert sees. Bobby Hebert is all set to dump this off to Jamal Anderson in the backfield. But when he sees the matchup that they've been waiting for, and that's Mathis on Eddie Robinson, the linebacker, he's ready to dump it over here. See him look, but then he says, hey, Brown's over there on the linebacker. I'll take that instead. You'll want a wide receiver on a linebacker.
Falcons have missed their last 3, make it 5 third down conversions. 3rd and 5. They got the first down here. Jamal Anderson spinning off the tacklers to the 49-yard line. So they get their first third down conversion over the last 6 attempts.
Well, and you saw the missed tackles there, Kev. They had an opportunity to tackle Jamal Anderson, and tackling was been a problem for this team. Dick Duran, the defensive coordinator, talked about it. Tom Coughlin talked about it. He said, last week we tackled terrible when they faced Chris Warren and the Seahawks.
First down and 10. Anderson into Jacksonville territory, picks up 3 to the 48. Calvin Pritchett closed the door.
I'll tell you something, Kevin. No matter what happens here, you have going down to 2-minute warning, and no matter what happens, if they go down and kick the game-winning field goal or whatever, I mean, you really have to credit the Falcons for coming here and showing up. Jacksonville has every reason to win this game, and Atlanta is fighting. They're out there scratching, clawing, whatever it takes.
Maybe fighting for their coach. Second down and seven. Hebert to Brown. He got a block, and there he goes. And Brown is on the move inside the 30 and to the Jacksonville 26. Tony Brackens made the stop, a gain of 22 yards.
And there's that play. There's that screen play that we've seen been so successful for him the whole game. Hebert takes off one way, turns around, throws the other. Now watch the block out there by the lineman.
Jacksonville had a 16-3 lead in the third quarter. It's now 19-17, Jaguars. Second and four. Hayward, wrapped up by the veteran Jeff Lagerman, came and plugged the middle, a gain of one. Atlanta took over on their own 30 with 3:57 left to play. Now they've got 1:36 left, and they've set things up nicely for Morton Anderson. Eighth play of the drive. Jamal Anderson, first down. Hayward in the backfield. First and 10. Ironhead gets it. Stood up and brought down by Davis. A gain of one. Second down and nine.
And that's what they're going to do. They're going to hand it to Ironhead. They're going to take him, give him the next shot, and just let him line up. Tell him to center it in the center of the field.
Hayward got drilled on this play. From inside the 12, and Hebert just falls center down.
Just gets it in the middle of the field.
After all those months of practice and training camp and games and travel and film and meetings, it may be all gone in 8 seconds.
Yeah, I tell you, it's tough. And if you look around the stadium, how quiet it is, and everybody's on their feet, and they're in disbelief. They can't believe what has happened. I don't think the players realized what was happening, even with 5 minutes to go in the game. I don't think they saw the big picture, and I think the coaching staff was looking ahead into the playoffs, thinking this was a give me. And, you know, with a young team, you learn a valuable lesson here today, and you realize that it doesn't matter in the NFL.
31-yard field goal attempt for the lead. And it's no good. Christmas has come early to Jacksonville.
This is magnified because it was a game winner. It was magnified because it got the Jaguars into the playoffs. And so I expect a lot of Christmas cards from people in Jacksonville from now on.
According to unconfirmed reports, by the way, Morton Anderson is running for elected office in Jacksonville this offseason. Anyway, what that result meant was that the Chiefs-Bills game, which was going on at the same time, had suddenly become a knockout contest, with the winners going into the playoffs and the losers going home for Christmas. We'll have that and the rest of the AFC playoff picture for you after the break.
So do you think Santa will like this big bowl of M&M's?
I don't know. I never met the fella. It doesn't exist.
They do exist.
Santa, this won't in any way affect my presence, will it?
The number one classical album. Probably the greatest collection of classical masterpieces ever. By the most highly acclaimed classical artists of our time. If you only ever buy one classical album, It must be the number one classical album, out now on CD and cassette. The X Factor cover-ups the paranormal mysteries UFOs. We give you the facts, you make up your own mind.
Hi, this is Nick Lowry with the New York Jets, formerly with the Kansas City Chiefs. And I've kicked 383 field goals, I think, in my career. And which is more than anybody ever else has. And you know where I learned? I learned to kick playing football, that is rugby football, and soccer at Collett Court, which is the junior school for St. Paul School on Kensington High Street, which is where it was back then. Now it's in Barnes across the river in Kensington. With a red brick building, Latin, French, and that's where I got all my good breeding. Was England. You're listening to Channel 4, the home of American football.
I'm watching it too. Now, let's do a quick recap. The Jaguars' win put them in the playoffs. Since the only thing that could eliminate the Colts was a tie between Kansas City and Buffalo, they were as good as in. That meant the Bills and Nick Lowry's old team were playing for the final place.
You believe.
Sudden death between the Bills and Chiefs, and Marty Schottenheimer's little engine that could speech wasn't much use against the Buffalo defense. They held Kansas City three times inside the 10-yard line, forcing them to settle for field goals. But with their own offense struggling, those three field goals had the Chiefs ahead until the fourth quarter, and a flu-ridden Jim Kelly finished them off with a couple of touchdown passes.
Kelly off the roll, throwing, touchdown, a wide open Tony Klein from the goal line. And Kelly fires, touchdown, win early.
Going to the big party, it's just been invited.
A place in the playoffs and a Tickle Me Elmo doll, what more could you want? Well, in New England's case, a bye week. That's what Bill Parcells' team were playing for at his old haunt, Giants Stadium. They didn't look like getting it in the first half, though. Drew Bledsoe threw two early interceptions, this one to Jason Sehorn, and took it 23 yards the other way for a touchdown. The unlikely halftime score, 22-0 to the Giants.
This is the NFC! This is our house! We're not the Jets! This is the Giants, baby!
Quite right, the Jets only blew a 21-point lead against New England this season. The Giants went one better.
Goes for the six to Glenn.
Kick to Megan at the 39, 45.
There he goes! Only the kicker to beat Wren. And Dave Megan gets a touchdown! Fourth down and seven. Trailing by five at the 14. Bledsoe to Coach. Complete at the one. And Coach struggles. Can he make it? To a single yet now. Touchdown!
So the Patriots get a week to rest and a home playoff game. The Colts couldn't get the bye, but they could at least be home for the wild card round if they beat the Bengals. The Bengals, though, were looking to finish the season even after starting with six defeats in seven games. Jeff Blake gave them the advantage with this pass to David Dunn and gave it back to the Colts.
Picked off! Jason Belzer, touchdown!
That set the pattern for the game. The Bengals would score, the Colts would come back, and at 24-17 in the fourth, he came back in style.
Taken by Aaron Bailey. Bailey's got room across the 30. Pass Johnson. It's Shane Tempeson. Touchdown. 95 yards, Aaron Bailey.
Someone had to score last, though, and it was the team that scored first. Jeff Blake's third touchdown pass of the game, a 9-yarder to Tony McGee, finished the season on a high note for Cincinnati and sent the Colts on the road for the playoffs. And here's a look at the final playoff picture in the AFC. The top two seeds get a first-round bye, which means that Pittsburgh, although they're division champs like the Broncos and Patriots, have to play a wild-card game. And here's confirmation of the wild-card placing. Buffalo, Jacksonville, and Indianapolis are all in, and all play this weekend. The only detail missing is who plays who, and that's what we're going to supply now.
Yeah.
kicked 23 game-winning field goals in his career, misses a chip shot.
Well, it was worth seeing again. The miss that gave the Jaguars their first ever postseason berth means Tom Coughlin will be bulk ordering the thermal underwear for a trip to Rich Stadium in Buffalo, where the Bills have never lost a playoff game. Their defense is playing championship football. The question is whether Jim Kelly can generate the offense to go with it. This one's a rematch of last year's AFC Championship game, which the Colts came within a last-second desperation pass of winning. As they were for that game, Jim Harbaugh and company will be underdogs, but after a hard season, they're finally getting healthy for their biggest game of the year.
Woo! Boy, I love this, baby. You can't get up for this game. You don't need to be here. Woo-hoo!
Having rested his ankle for most of last week, Jerome Bettis should be close to full speed, and there'll be plenty in the Steelers' game plan, featuring Cordell Stewart at quarterback. Now, while the top six in the AFC are looking forward to the playoffs, the Jets, to no one's surprise, are looking for a new head coach. Realizing he was going to be pushed at the end of the season, Rich Kotite jumped last week, which means that since 1978, the Jets have had as many head coaches as they have winning seasons, five. But whether it was Pat Ryan, Ken O'Brien, or Boomer Esiason at quarterback, Walt Michaels or Joe Walton with his head in his hands on the sideline, the Clark family have always been there. Every Jets home game without fail for the past 19 seasons. And last weekend was their 148th in a row.
Oh, there's the stadium. Can you believe this is the 148th game, Sophie?
I would have stopped a long time ago, except you keep making me go to these games. Jackie, what's up?
Hey, how you doing, Chris? Number
good.
One.
8 for 8.
8 for 8. How are you? I'll see you again.
A lot has to do with my wife. When the Jets got bad, she came in, she added a lot to the tailgate, and it's still fun.
It's the tailgate we come for. It's a social event, and the heck with the team.
We do it 8 times a year for our home games, and there are a few of us here who don't ever miss a game.
It all started back in 1964, the year they came into Shea Stadium, and my father couldn't really get the Giant tickets. He was with the Harrington Park Firemen, and they all decided they would get Jet tickets.
All right, here he is.
Joe Willie.
Number 12, Joe Willie.
Last winning season.
The savior. Back in those days, that's when the Jets owned the town, and everybody was a Jet fan back then.
As the Jets got bad in the 70s, the people from the fire department started to give up the tickets. My father started to accumulate them, and there we go. Give me a J!
J!
Give me an E!
B!
Give me a T!
T!
Give me an S!
S!
What is better?
Jets!
Jets!
Jets! Jets!
Sofa, Heidi said these are bad seats. Are you kidding me? These are the best seats in the house. You could see a running play. You could see a pass pattern develop.
Jets 3 of 8 on third down. They need 9 on this one.
Touchdown! Kyle Brady, my main man, Kyle!
Yeah!
This is his 148th straight Jet game. This goes back to 1978.
Defense! Someone came in, a wide receiver came in and just crushed Bobby Houston. It's 21-21.
He has come all different weathers, all different times of the year. He came Christmas Eve last year. He lived in Baltimore for a year and didn't miss a game. He lived in Connecticut for a year and didn't miss a game.
In.
He is the ultimate Jet fan.
Put it in, Jets! Yeah!
We're on our way to the Super Bowl!
Jets!
This could be our first win, home win of the season.
First one in 11 games. The people we see here eight times a year, you become friends.
When we moved here from Shea Stadium, we didn't know them at all. And Chris, the first couple of years, kept spilling beer on me. And we didn't have a good relationship. But then Heidi came. And because of Heidi's relationship with Chris, he's straightened out, and we've become really good friends here. And this is, even if we could switch seats, we wouldn't because of them. We send holiday cards back and forth to each other. If there's a big event in your family, like a birth in the family or whatever, you send it to the people in your section.
J-E-T-S!
The NFL talks about tradition and whatnot, and that's what we have.
Ends with a 1-15 season. As the final seconds tick off, the final will be Miami 31 and the Jets 28.
Even though our team is horrible, we still look upon this as something that we'll be doing the rest of our lives. Something I hope my son will have his kids coming to and also doing it.
He's definitely a loyal fan, and we need more of those type of fans to come out and support the Jets.
It's amazing. What else can you say, really? That's dedication, perseverance. You know, I think there's a lot of guys on this team that had perseverance to make it through this season, but for them to make it through 148 straight games is amazing.
Another typical Jet loss where they're leading early in the first half and then lose it in the second half. Maybe it'll be better in your day, Chris.
The Clark family, I thought, are with them this holiday season. The Jets won win this year, by the way, came on the road in Arizona. We're going to switch to the NFC now. Not so much to be decided there in terms of wildcard places on the final weekend, but there was still one division title up for grabs.
I've been around long, but I know something special going on here.
May have to get out here and have a little fun. Do a little something.
The something special the Panthers were after with the NFC West title, and Kerry Collins put them ahead with this pass to Wesley Walls. The little something Cordell Stewart was promising turned out to be an 80-yard touchdown run, the longest by a quarterback in NFL history.
Slash Stewart looking to run, and he's on the roll. Slash Stewart across the 30, into open field. Look at this man go. Cordell Stewart on the run. It's a foot race. He's going to win it to the end zone.
The Panthers wrapped up Stewart long enough to take an 18-14 lead, but Cordell came back. Ernie Mills dropped one perfect pass in the end zone, and with 29 seconds left, Stewart had the Steelers in position to win it again at the 1 yard line.
It's intercepted!
And they beat the 49ers to the NFC West title. In fact, the Panthers had a chance for home field advantage throughout the playoffs, as long as the Packers lost to the Vikings by at least 18 points. A pretty big if, but not impossible. The Vikings defense tried to set the tone early on. A strong candidate for hit of the season by Corey Fuller on Antonio Freeman. Just a bump in the road, as it turned out, for the Green Bay juggernaut.
Here's Levins on the screen pass. Blocking in front, touchdown, Packers.
The Panthers' win have made the 49ers' final game meaningless from a team standpoint. There was plenty at stake for the individuals, especially Barry Sanders, who ran for 175 yards, including this 54-yard touchdown, to snatch the rushing title from Denver's Terrell Davis and teach us a lesson for counting our chickens on the big match. Steve Young had a down year and still won the passing title for the fifth time in six seasons, and Jerry Rice caught five passes to finish with 108, two ahead of the Lions' Herman Moore for the most in the league. The 49ers won the game, by the way. Whether that's an autograph or a throwing tip Steve Young's writing on Scott Mitchell's hand, we may never know. The new total body face mask will be available for quarterbacks from next season. Too late for Kent Graham in this one. With nothing at stake except momentum for the postseason, the Eagles built a sizable lead on Mike Mamula's fumble recovery and Ricky Waters' 1 yard touchdown run. Although they won the game, Ray Rhodes won't have been pleased at this poor decision from his quarterback, Ty Detmer.
And Detmer's pass is picked off by Aeneas Williams. Aeneas racing down the sidelines into the end zone.
So here's how things stand in the NFC. The Packers, Panthers, and Cowboys go in as division champions. The Packers' record of 13 wins, ensuring that they'll play all their games at Lambeau Field. Among the wild cards, the Vikings and Eagles' final results meant they switched places in the seedings. But it hardly matters because they both face difficult games on the road. Playing a wildcard game is a new experience for San Francisco. The opposition will be familiar. Philadelphia's Ray Rhodes used to coach the 49ers defense. And Ricky Waters was their running back the last time they won the Super Bowl. Waters faded a bit towards the end of the regular season. As a running threat, he's still in a different class to anything the 49ers have. San Francisco are out to reassert themselves after losing the NFC West title to Carolina. If their egos are fragile, they're as healthy physically as they've been all year. Steve Young hasn't pulled a hamstring or seen double for at least 3 weeks. And with Jerry Rice playing as well as he has all year, it should be an interesting matchup of West Coast offenses. Like the 49ers, the Cowboys miss out on their usual end-of-year week off and face one of the hottest quarterbacks in the league at the moment, Vikings' Brad Johnson. We'll be profiling Johnson a bit later, but suffice it to say that he's played well enough to displace Warren Moon as Chris Carter's delivery man. Carter against Deion Sanders could be a great matchup. The Cowboys are probably less worried about Minnesota's offense than they are about their own. In their last three games, they've mustered a grand total of 2 touchdowns, and the defending Super Bowl champions will need to recapture last year's ruthlessness inside the red zone if they want to defend it for much longer. After the break, we'll check on Brad Johnson's rising status in Minnesota, give you the latest coaching unemployment figures, and profile the great Dick Night Train Lane. See you in a couple of minutes.
Having Lucretia Borgia for lunch wasn't such a good idea.
A touch of heartburn, Master.
Yes.
If you suffer heartburn or indigestion, one Zantac 75 will prevent the production of further excess acid and go on working beyond your next meal.
So, will Sir be fit for tonight's soiree?
Ah, yes.
What's for dinner?
Barbecued sinner.
Zantac 75, devilishly effective against heartburn.
If you've got a battery-operated smoke alarm, it's essential that you carry out the following simple checks. Test the battery every month by pressing this button. And once a year, replace the battery and remove dust from the sensor with a vacuum cleaner. Look after your smoke alarm. If it doesn't wake you, maybe nothing will. Wake up. Check your smoke alarm.
Going to happen quick. Remember, said it's a shorter draft.
Warren Moon went into training camp this season just like he has every season since 1984 as the number one quarterback on his team. But no sooner was the snap count out of his mouth in the Vikings opener than he was out of the game with an ankle injury and his position was under threat.
When Warren went down in that first game against Detroit, you could see that the players were going to rally to Brad simply because they knew that he needed that support and that they were going to have to step up their level of play for us to do well, and that Brad was being put into that position.
Of course, once Moon was healthy, Johnson was put back into that holding the clipboard position on the sideline. And that's how things stayed until week 11, when the Vikings were thrashed by the Seahawks. Moon was benched in that game, and bad ankle or not, he hasn't been back.
It has been an unusual season for me because I'm not used to being hurt. And every time I have been hurt in my career, it was an injury where you're out 4 weeks because you fractured a bone or something like that, and you know in 4 weeks you're going to be back in the lineup. But this has been just a nagging injury since the beginning of the season that I tried to play with for about 6 or 7 weeks, and all I did was get it worse. I'm used to being out there, I want to be out there, and I can't.
Johnson with time, throws a strike to Reed. Jake Reed is gone.
You know, I'd be lying to say no, I knew all along Brad was going to play this well. I knew Brad would play well. He'd been with me for 5 years. He knows this offense extremely well. And he's got all the physical tools. Until someone steps into the arena for an extended period of time to really know what it is to be the starting quarterback, you can't be absolutely sure.
My role here has been a backup, and to earn respect in the NFL, it's not what you say, it's what you do on the field. And I think I've gained some respect by getting a chance to play, and guys, you know, they do recognize I have some leadership qualities, especially on the field.
The question is, how does a young quarterback develop leadership qualities when most of his week is spent playing follow the leader? The answer in Johnson's case, as London Monarch fans will know, was to sign up for the World League.
When Brad played in the World League, we were convinced that he could be the good backup quarterback, and when given a chance to play, could step in and play because he's smart and has really been just waiting for his turn.
The World League was just a phenomenal experience because I got to go through every situation, whether it was coming off a high and throwing 3 touchdowns or coming off a loss and throwing 4 picks. And I had to go through that emotional roller coaster, and that, I think that just it just prepared me for this level right here at the NFL. Playing behind Warren, it's been great. I've learned so much from him, and in the past 3 years, he hasn't been hurt at all, and I really haven't had a chance to play in a meaningful game or get a start. And this year, it's just he's had an unfortunate injury, and I've been given a lot of time, and I think just I've worked so hard and spending time going to the World League and just finally, and knowing the system and finally getting a chance, and I've kind of jumped all over that opportunity and made the most of it. So it's been a dream come true.
I'm happy for Brad because he's worked very hard to get to this point, and I've watched him the last 3 years since we've been playing together. I've seen his development. I know he's been waiting for his chance to play. I never thought I'd play as long as I have, so I'm sure he was a little frustrated the fact that I was coming back another year, because I first thought I was only going to play 2 years. But now he's getting his opportunity, and he's making the most of it.
And having led the Vikings into the playoffs, Johnson, who earned just $15,000 in the World League, signed a 4-year contract for $15.5 million. Moon still out-earned him at $4 million a year, but at the age of 40, 12 years older than Johnson, he's already talking like a man who knows that the heir to his job has already succeeded.
I'm a very competitive person, and I know my days are numbered as far as how long I want to play or how long I'm going to have the ability to play, so I want to play as much as I possibly can. So it's very frustrating for me right now. But from a team standpoint, I'm very happy because Brad's playing well and making this team better as far as getting towards the playoffs.
Time to wrap up the rest of the action from the final weekend of the regular season now, starting with the last ever game at RFK Stadium.
It is out.
Tennyson.
sack. And Seattle has it. Let's stop. Big down. Pass is complete. This is Joey Galloway into the end zone. And guess what? The Seattle Seahawks have the lead.
And remember, ending the game on a positive note, and the Seattle Seahawks somehow, some way, have managed to end it on a positive note.
Elway trying to scramble, watch the football. San Diego has it. Musgrave, good protection over the middle. Bobble and intercepted. Humphries over the middle and it's complete to Jones. Touchdown.
Eddie George again. And he's in for a touchdown for the Oilers on their opening drive of the game. The rookie out of Ohio State.
He's
going to
run,
and he's going to run for the first down, and he's going to run even more for a touchdown. And I think it's time to say that this is the Oilers' starting quarterback for a long time to come.
That's all the action from the final weekend of the regular season. Here's your chance to check where your team finished.
In the NFL is that special time of year when millionaire team owners like to drop in on their head coach, give him half an hour to clear his desk, and have security escort him to the car park. Rich Kotite, as you already know, is history, and come Christmas morning, he wasn't the only one at home counting his redundancy money.
Now, you're all here to ask me a question. Don't ask it, because I can't answer it.
I feel a tremendous hurt for players that I have a very good feeling about that I won't be a part of, you know, whatever success that they might have. You know, I'm leaving some players that I feel very good about and very close to, so that's the part that hurts.
You're fired.
Have we done an awful job? Hell no, we haven't done an awful job. Have we done as well as I'd like to? Hell no, we haven't done as well as I'd like to. But are we improved, and is this team headed in the right direction? Absolutely.
You're fired.
It's a very tough time, but I appreciate the players that played for me and had a good time while I was here. It just didn't work out. That's the nature of this business, and hopefully the next guy will have better luck.
You're fired.
This loss really hurt. This loss really hurt. This loss really hurt.
Fired.
Right now, Wayne Fonts and his staff are no longer the coaches of the Detroit Lions.
Don't feel sorry for me. It's a chapter in my life that's over. It's been just fantastic run for me.
Dick Night Train Lane is the only player in NFL history to have a James Brown song named after him. Unless, of course, you count Billick, it's a man's Will Smith, who we'll get to later in the series. Anyway, during his 14 seasons with the Rams, the Cardinals and the Lions, Night Train Lane proved himself to be one of the game's best ever defensive backs. In 1952, his rookie season, Lane had 14 interceptions, an NFL record which still stands, unlike most of his opponents, because as well as being one of the best, Lane was probably the most physical cornerback the game's ever seen, and his speciality, still legal in those days, was the clothesline tackle.
or the night train necktie, as it was affectionately known around the league.
Because if you don't hit him right, you break your elbow, your arm or something, you know. So you got to really get him right in front of him and hit him with that forearm and rip him up.
Lane wore 81, which these days you'd see on a wide receiver. And he actually did some time on offense, catching a 98-yard touchdown pass for the Cardinals, which is still the longest play in team history. The night train finally pulled into Canton in 1974.
The night train.
Now our first set of Super Bowl tickets has already been won, so there's only one pair left and 3 weeks to win them if you want to be in New Orleans at the end of January. The weekly prizes are as plentiful as ever, a good two dozen of them, including the official Super Bowl 31 football. Question concerns Night Train Lane's last NFL stop, Detroit. We want to know how many coaches the Lions have sacked this week. All right, how many Super Bowls they've won. Is it one, two, or none at all? 0891-444-444 is the number to call, and lines close at midnight on Thursday. Last week, we asked which city the Rams left LA for, and it was St. Louis.
Now, don't forget, this Monday's road to the Super Bowl will be on at 5 in the evening. No need to worry about staying up late for once, and we'll have action from all four wildcard games for you. To close the door on the regular season, though, we're going to go out this week with a small tribute to those who won't be with us for the playoffs. 5 o'clock on Monday, don't forget.
Oh!